This is the MLW Radio Network.
Welcome, everybody, to the Mind of the Meanie, your weekly peek into the world, according to former WWE superstar and ECW original, the Blue Meanie. We cover wrestling, music, movies, sports, and lots of useless knowledge, all contained in the Mind of the Meanie. I am your temporary tour guide and stepdaddy extraordinaire, Adam Bernard, and he is the Blue Meanie. Meanie, what is on your mind?
You're not Josh.
No, I am not, sir. I am the Wish.com version of Josh Chernoff.
Josh is a busy boy. Busy boy.
Good for him, though, man. He's been killing it, dude.
Yeah. Well, we've all been busy.
We've got a lot. Everybody's got a lot going on right now, yeah, but it's not. Nothing is in a bad context. You know, it's all good stuff, which is a good thing.
Since we've last talked, you've moved.
I have a brand new background here. I am back in lovely Downingtown, Pennsylvania, in lovely Chester County. So I'm happy to be back on the eastern side of the state, which is great.
How far are you from the Downingtown Farmers Market?
Really close, actually. I think we're only about 5 minutes away. So
that's where ECW used to run. Yeah.
One more time?
ECW used to run the shows there.
No shit. That's awesome, man. Yeah. We're right back off of Route 30, so we're not very far from pretty much everything. But yeah, it's been a hell of an experience getting back. The movers stole my son's Xbox, and that was a whole ordeal. Yeah, dude. So my son James is 8, and one of my brothers got him an Xbox 360. And somewhere between Bethel Park, which is out in Pittsburgh where we used to live, and out here, they took the Xbox and had his controller, this like cool purple controller. And like, he saved all this stuff and he had like super long progress. He's like a Lego kid. So he had Harry Potter and Star Wars and all that shit. And they stole it off the truck. And I blew up. If you follow me on Twitter, you saw it, but I blew up the company that was the moving team. And, you know, I was like, this is unacceptable. You'd steal from a fucking 8 year old, like, for Christ's sakes, he's 8 years old. You took his Xbox. The company was super apologetic and they wouldn't admit that it happened, though, right? Like, they wouldn't admit that it was stolen. They just said that there were serious irregularities in the stories. For legal purposes, I'll leave out like sort of more of the,
of course,
you know, internal workings of it. But the representative said that there were serious irregularities. So they ended up giving us like a really great, like, you know, concession repayment kind of thing. Like, they gave us a bunch of money back that we paid. And their reps were really, really great about it. Like, the woman that I spoke to was just like crushed. She was like, I can't believe this happened. Like, I've been in this industry for 15 years and this is the first time this has ever happened. And, it was an ordeal. But luckily he has a brand new Xbox One now and he is, happy as a pig in shit with those games. So, yeah, but we're settling in, man. It's nice to, like I said, it's nice to be back. It's nice to be here, back in Philly. And I know we've got to see each other a couple of times now since, I've been back, right?
Yeah. It's become a thing almost. It's like,
it's pretty rad, right?
Yeah. You were at the, Icons convention and then,
which was dope.
And then I ran into you at MLW.
Which was amazing. I don't know if we've really had a chance to talk about that, but I actually, for the first time, actually got to see Blue Meanie wrestle in person, which was amazing.
Well, I wouldn't call it wrestling, but, you know.
Dude, that splash you took, man, that looked pretty, pretty painful, man. I got to tell you, that guy was a big boy coming down on top of you. But that was really cool. That was a very, very cool event. MLW Fightland, I guess that aired last week, the big Hammerstone and Fatu match, which was, if you were in a crowd, man, they fucking tore it down. Those guys left everything in the ring that night. And I was incredibly impressed by that match.
Which is also amazing because Hammerstone totally wrecked his ankle during that match and continued. You know, I mean, God bless him. He posted a photo on, you know, his Twitter. Like, as soon as he walked through the curtain, he basically had to go, you know, take a seat because his ankle was just wrecked. And the fact that, you know, Hammerstone just continued that match through all that was amazing. It's a testament to his hard work. But, you know, both those guys, him and Fatu, just amazing. Amazing athletes. Just, just make it look way too easy, and I'm envious, you know?
It was, I mean, they did. They made it look effortless. Like, watching Hammerstone, like, so I was sitting with a friend of mine, Candace Cordelia. She reports for Pro Wrestling Illustrated, and she and I were sitting together, and we watched, I don't remember exactly what happened, but all of a sudden, we saw Hammerstone stand up, and his leg was shaking. So initially I was like, oh fuck, he just blew his knee out. You know, because the way his leg was moving, my first thought was, oh shit, that's a knee injury, right?
Right.
Which we then found out after the show, we were standing sort of backstage in the backstage area, and we saw him come in, and I mean, his ankle was already starting to swell, and it was like, oh my God, dude. Luckily, Hammerstone, it seems to be in good shape. It seems like it was just a sprain, which is a good thing. As far as I'm aware, I don't know if he's broken anything like officially, but he did win the MLW World Heavyweight Championship. But that was impressive to know how bad that sprain was, and that he continued to perform after that. That was just incredible. Like, just a testament to him as a performer and an individual. And Fatu, I mean, the Contra stuff, like, that has me hooked, man. That's almost as good as the I'll tell you, man, I enjoy that as much as the Bloodline stuff in some respects. You know, I feel like there's definitely some parallels between the two. Obviously, you know, the familial relation, but yeah, I had a really good time. How was your experience there overall? I mean, after the splash, obviously.
Well, MLW is always a good time. I love working there. The crew's great. You know, everybody's great, from court to, you know, the wrestlers to people behind the scenes. You know, it's always cool to work with Charlie from ECW, the camera guy. You know, it's just always good just to see people and get to apply my trade with MLW. And again, they're coming back November 6th. I believe my match from Fightland airs somewhere around Thanksgiving-ish.
So, oh, okay.
Since it was like a 12-man elimination tag match, they kind of want to have it to air around like when Survivor Series would air, kind of thing.
Yeah.
And that, you know, that it's a smart thing by court. But, yeah. MLW is always a great time. And like I said, it's nice to work for a great company, and it's also great to work, you know, 10 minutes from your house where you're in bed, you know, you know.
Don't even have to really do anything after the shower. Just get out and fucking go, man.
Yeah.
Get out of there.
Just walk home, take a shower, and get in bed. And, you know, every night before we go to sleep, me and Mrs. Meanie watch the movie What We Do in the Shadows. It's like...
Okay.
It's like one of those things, you know, like... When I go to bed, I need noise. I need sound. Yeah. I can't, if it's totally silent, I can't sleep, because
interesting,
it's weird. So we always had like it. I've always had the radio on or TV on, and like one of our favorite movies is What We Do in the Shadows, which is a fake documentary about vampires living in New Zealand.
Okay.
And they've even, you know, turned it into a TV show, you know, loosely based on the movie. But yeah, just get in bed and watch that. And I, because it takes off the pressure of having to pay attention. If you know something well enough, you're just like, oh, okay, here's the part where then you're, you know,
yep.
Not that the movie's bad, but you're just comfortable enough to where, you know, oh, okay, I don't have to pay attention. It's a background noise right now. So. But, yeah, MLW, back to that, fantastic company. It's always cool when, you know, I could say, I tagged with, you know, Savio Vega, you know. I've always admired. Funny guy, great guy. The match was a bit much to put together. Not in a bad way, just when you got that many people in the match. It's hard enough to wrangle your, in a singles match, you know, get with your, you know, opponent and referee and agent. Imagine gathering 12 people.
Right.
It's like herding cats. It's like wrangling cats. You know, just come here. Stay here. Don't leave. You know, where are you going? But
everybody's got their ideas. Everybody's got a thought of what they could do. Yeah, I mean, that sounds dreadful in some respects, but I mean, it looked flawless. It looked effortless when you guys pulled it off. So Well, Meanie got a big pop, by the way, guys. Make sure you watch that on TV, man. Meanie got a fucking loud pop. I was in the crowd while I was facing the ring right at the hard camera side. And when he came out, man, the place went fucking ballistic, dude. I'm telling you, it was, you know, the hometown guy, man. And plus, I mean, who doesn't like the Blue Meanie? Like, if you don't like the Blue Meanie, you probably need your head examined. But
well, I'll go to my go-to answer of they're all my neighbors.
I just give away free tickets.
Yeah, it's a work. I just, you know,
it's a work. Pal.
I went up and down the street to put tickets in mailboxes. You know.
Staple them to the door.
Yeah.
No, it was cool to watch, man. I really enjoyed myself. I thought it was a great event. I was actually there with my friend. I was helping out my friend Duke Bennett from a podcast called Duke Loves Wrestling.
Nice.
And Duke Loves Wrestling, rather. And he was able to get me in there and, you know, did a quick spot for him. So you can go back into that archive and listen to that coverage as well. You know, my follow up story on that. But I'll be there next time supporting both Duke Loves Wrestling and Foundation Radio. Doing some coverage for MLW. So I hope to see everybody there for the next round. But yeah, I guess for some reason, I never took my picture in front of the big ECW like mural in the men's room. You know, I had been there a couple of times before, not even realizing it at first, like a couple of years ago. I used to do photography for a size inclusive clothing brand in Philadelphia. They're now based in France, but they used to be in Philadelphia. And at one point, I guess it was 2018 or 2019, they did a fashion show at the 2300 Arena.
Okay.
I guess it just completely blew, like it just like didn't even connect to me that I was in the ECW arena at the time because I was so focused on like getting there and doing the shots and I didn't even use the bathroom. So when I went back, I was like, oh my God, I was here. You know, like it just like everything clicked. I was like, I'm fucking idiot. But yeah, really great event. Like I said, MLW puts on an incredible show. So if you guys get a chance to go and check it out, you definitely should because it's absolutely worth every penny you're going to spend. But no, as far as going back to like falling asleep, though, Meanie, I wanted to touch base on that with you as well.
Sure.
My wife is the same way. My wife, Courtney, she has to have something playing in the background. And it's a deliberative action every night before we go to bed is what is Courtney going to watch when she goes to sleep? You know, and it's always like that's the running joke is, oh, what are you going to watch while you're sleeping tonight? You know, oh, I don't know. I want to be able to watch Friends. I want to watch this, you know. So it's always I'm the opposite, though. I need it like almost silent to fall asleep. Like I can deal with like a little bit of background noise and a little bit of white noise. But anything more than that is just like so it's this constant like battle between us at like 10. You're at like 12:30. I'm like, babe, please turn it down. I can't fucking sleep, you know. So what's up?
I need sound, but, you know, sometimes she'll watch something and whatever, like, what was the show? She would watch, Mrs. Meanie will watch Adventure Time.
Okay.
And sometimes it would be too bright. So when my eyes are closed, I can like kind of see the back of my eyelids. So Mrs. Meanie went and constructed a sleep mask for me to put on.
No shit.
So I if something's too bright, I put on the sleep mask and
there you go.
Yeah, I'm out like a baby. You know, it's just like it only takes me to go, oh, this where we're yeah.
Yep, I'm out. I'm done. Yep. Good for you, man.
Oh, it's nice and dark and
that's awesome, dude.
I've officially become my grandfather. Just like I could fall asleep at the drop of a hat, you know.
Dude, it's so crazy, man. I'm telling you, the older I get, the more I'm like that too. The more I'm like, how did this happen? Like, how did I become this person? It used to take me forever to fall asleep. I mean, I don't know if you guys can tell just by listening to me, but I'm a pretty like hyperactive dude. I'm just constant. Like if you could see me like tapping underneath, like if you could see like my whole body while I'm recording this show or like my own show, I'm just like tapping on something and my legs are shaking because I'm just such a moving guy. So it used to take me a really long time to fall asleep and just like to calm myself. But now, like the older I've gotten, it's just like I am just asleep in like 30 seconds. And Courtney's like, what the fuck? How do you fall asleep that quickly? You know? And I'm like, I don't know. I guess I'm just my dad now. That's just how it's going to be.
Yeah. Every now and then I'll have issues where like my brain won't shut down or I get that restless leg that just doesn't want to, you know, chill the fuck out. And when it comes to that, I'll just hop in a shower, take a blazing hot shower and just loosen everything up. And then, you know, that's like a warm cup of milk to me. I'm just like, you know, just piss right out, you know?
That's actually not a bad idea. I didn't even think about that. That's actually, that's a really excellent idea. I'm going to try next time. Because the other night.
What's that?
I was going to say the other night I had that. I was up, like, I would fall asleep and I was up and I'd fall asleep and I was up and I was just like fucking driving myself insane, you know? I think full disclosure, I'm back on my my anxiety medicine. Made the decision to do that recently, which I think it's, you know, if you can make those kinds of decisions, you should. But anyway, I think a common side effect of that is insomnia and like restlessness.
Yeah.
So I think that was just, you know, and I remember the last time I started it, there was a couple of days where that happened. This time, luckily, it was only the one. But yeah, dude, I just could not fucking calm my brain. Couldn't get situated. Couldn't get settled.
Yeah.
And, you know, so now I'm back. But
dude, go take a blazing hot shower. Like the Meanie household, we're a let's take a shower before bed kind of thing. You know, wash the filth of the day off and get into some nice clean sheets. So, you know, I'll take a shower. And, like, if I feel like I'm going to be extra restless, like, I'll, you know, when I wash my hair, I'll just, like, let the heat, you know, let the, you know, water hit my head and then just dry off real quick, jump in bed, and then out.
Smart.
Out.
Smart, man.
Yeah.
I have to remember that next time.
Yeah, it's like
a... Let us know... If you're listening right now, let us know what your tips and trades are for us to fall asleep faster. Hit us up at Mind of the Meanie and let us know so we can talk about it next time.
Yeah, I'm sure we got some pod squads there in the chat, yep. In the old chat room.
Yeah, pod squad. What's up, everybody? Nice to see everyone today. Hello, hello. Travis is here. Vanessa, hello. Good morning, everyone. Yeah, I mean, it was also, I got a chance to do my first, my official first, like, Patreon
nice.
Group chat with everybody, with you guys last week, which was super cool. It's nice to put like faces and voices to the names I see on like the scroll here.
Yeah.
You know, like it was finally nice to see everybody. Everything is good. Travis, I have never actually been called Nard Dog before. However, there was someone that I used to work with or went to school with. I went to Westchester University, so we did a lot of like group projects and shit in some of the classes, and he specifically referred to me as Andy Barnard, which, if you are aware of who Andy Barnard is, he is the character from The Office played by Ed Helms. And no matter how many times I would correct him, he would call me Andy in projects. He would put my name on projects as Andy. So no, Nard Dog, I have not gotten before, but I'm sure now that we are listening, that will be the name. I'm going to go back through some of these comments here as well. Jacob Fatu. Yeah, Travis. Jacob Fatu was incredible. He was so good in the ring. I mean, that both, I would say, and I know Meanie can probably agree with this too, Hammerstone and Fatu, they both have long, illustrious careers ahead of them based on what I saw their match. I mean, they're the future, and I'm convinced of it. I wouldn't be surprised to see Fatu pop up in NXT, and then eventually if the Bloodline keeps going. I mean, I think that would be an incredible addition to that. As a big muscle part of the group, you know, it's more of like the larger Usos. What do you think, Meanie? What do you think about that?
Yeah, I mean, the world is Fatu's oyster. I mean, he could basically, you know, write his ticket to anything. I mean, and he's just such a natural. You know, he comes from a good bloodline. You know, no pun intended. You know, the Samoan dynasty is no joke. I mean, a long line of, you know, proud Polynesian wrestlers. You know, Hammerstone has a longer career ahead of him. And if you've followed his journey through, you know, growing up, training, and then getting into bodybuilding, he's had a pretty cool journey as well if you watch his evolution. So it's just starting off for him, for those two. This is just the beginning. And kudos to MLW for giving these two talents a platform to apply their trade, you know. And, you know, they built up that match for a while, and it delivered on every level, you know, every point.
Yeah.
Every point you can make in that match they made. And, I mean, the highlights that they put on Twitter, you know, don't do it justice. You got to see that whole match in its entirety. And the fact that, you know, Hammerstone, like, wrecked his ankle, you know, midway through that match and still, you know, weathered that ankle injury. Because, like, look, I've had my share of ankle injuries, you know. I'm, like, flat-footed. So, like, I have no arch support or whatever. And then, like, for whatever reason, my ankle just, like, likes to roll and go whoop, you know.
Ooh.
You know,
Jesus.
Plenty of times, you know, over my life, I've twisted my ankle just walking. You know, just stupid shit. You know, I've
Yeah, dude.
It's always the stupid injuries that hurt the worst. But I felt his pain looking at that ankle. I was like, but buddy, you just gotta raise it and, you know, soak that thing in some Epsom salts, you know. He's like, I'm throwing the kitchen sink at it. You know, so and he was supposed to be on the I did a show last Saturday for standalone wrestling. He was supposed to be on that show. He had to cancel, which was a shame. But yeah, tough kid. They were both tough guys. Both, you know, Fatu. I mean, you know, I'm just basically repeating myself, but you know, they're amazing.
They were, again, that show was again, like Meanie said, if you didn't get a chance to watch the full match, go ahead, go out of your way and watch it, because it is worth it. I felt like the buildup for it on Twitter and most of the social media platforms was as good as the Cardona stuff in GCW. I thought it was, you know, there was a lot of hype behind that match.
Yeah.
And I think for me, anyway, it really, really delivered. So Vanessa wanted to let us know about our sleep problems, that she drinks stuff called NeuroBliss, which calms her mind. They have a sleep version and an energy version. My luck, Vanessa, I would end up with the fucking energy version before I went to sleep, because that's the kind of shit that I would do, because I'm an idiot. So what do you think? Are you going to give it a try, Meanie?
I don't know if I need any help going to sleep.
like, at least not anymore, right? Maybe on like the off occasion that I have trouble going to bed. Travis said, yeah, he agreed with us about Jacob Fatu. He said the SmackDown World title picture, I don't think he'd be out of place at all. Imagine Paul Heyman deciding Jacob Fatu was the guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, dude. Fuck yeah. I would love to see even Jacob Fatu go and crush Nakamura and give the entire bloodline gold. You know, bring Naomi in, give her the women's title on SmackDown, have Fatu or someone else from the family come in, take the Intercontinental strap, throw the U.S. give the entire bloodline the gold and do it across. For me, anyway, and this might be controversial, meaning, and I'll ask you about this, but I think Roman Reigns should be like an effervescent character. He should be everywhere. Raw, SmackDown, he should be, him and the Usos and Paul Heyman, they should be free agents. And I think the reason why is because there's a lot of opportunity for characters on both brands to cross mingle. But I also think Roman Reigns is like, he is that guy. And I think that there's a lot of opportunity for him to sort of be dominant and rule over the entire WWE universe. What do you think about that?
That's kind of why what I miss about like having one world championship, which was, you know, defended on both shows, kind of, you know, just you know, I'm not a big fan of the brand split, but I get it, and sometimes they, you know they ignore the rules of it, and you know, people still show up on other shows anyway and stuff like that, so I'm just like, eh. But like, you know, Roman's amazing. you know, what we're seeing now has always been there. It's just, you know, I don't know if they did his heel turn a little too late, but you know, they think, oh well, it's going well. It's going really well.
Yeah.
But they could have done it sooner. Like I said, you know, he was a victim of the Royal Rumble, where the one year they wanted Daniel Bryan to win. And when Daniel Bryan got eliminated, then everybody was cheering for Roman Reigns to win. So WWE is like, oh, well, this Roman Reigns character, let's have him win next year. So the next year they go to win, and Daniel Bryan gets eliminated again. Then they finally give it to Roman Reigns, and they're like, well, no, we wanted Daniel Bryan to have
Daniel Bryan.
So, you know, he carried that stigma of being the guy that, you know, cock-blocked fucking Daniel Bryan from winning Royal Rumble.
Cock. Should that be the name of the episode? Roman Reigns cock block Daniel Bryan.
No, I don't need that.
Obviously not. No, but that would be hilarious.
I don't need that. I don't need that heat.
Yeah, here comes a call. Here comes, yeah, Meanie's going to get a call from Vince. God damn it, Meanie. Now, I agree. And I guess to your point, as far as Roman Reigns is concerned, I think this was the last opportunity for them to do something like this. But I don't necessarily think it was too late, like in his career. I think, at least in my opinion, because I've never booked, I've never wrestled, I've never done anything. I'm just a guy who watches the shows, right? I'm just a fan. But I think a lot of this, the bloodline stuff and the Paul Heyman stuff, was only possible because of the pandemic. it was only possible for him to go away from TV for a while. Because you remember he was supposed to fight Goldberg at WrestleMania.
Yeah.
Goldberg leaves. Strowman comes in. It's the stuff with The Fiend. Roman comes back in like August or July. And he's this like ambiguous. Is he a heel? Is he a face? Nobody really knows. And then it just morphs into this incredible, almost, and this might be a little controversial, but in some respects, almost like a Stone Cold character, where are you supposed to cheer for him or are you supposed to boo him, right? And it seems like, at least when I saw him in Pittsburgh, there were a lot of people who were cheering him over booing him. And people, you know, the numbers don't lie. But I think that this circumstance specifically with the pandemic worked itself out because of the pandemic. And I think had that not happened, they may have had a much more difficult time getting him over as the character, because there were a lot of things they were able to do in the Thunderdome that they may not have been able to do live.
Right.
You know, a lot of test things that they may not, you know, Roman's a really quiet talker. So it allowed that space and that venue allowed him to do a lot more talking in a way that was going to, because if you notice now, a lot of times he only goes on the mics and says, acknowledge me. And then Paul is the guy that talks, or the Usos are the guy, you know what I mean? So they're learning, right? But no, I don't necessarily think it was too late, but I think if they had waited any longer, it may not have been as fruitful, right? Like a Cena heel turn now, that's not going to do any, that's not going to move any needles.
No.
That ship has sailed a long time ago.
Yeah.
What do you think? I mean, do you think that it was a product of the pandemic, or do you think that based on your experience in the industry and your experiences with like writing and TV and stuff, do you think that they could have done a Roman Reigns heel turn as effectively if the pandemic hadn't have happened?
I'm sure they could have, but you know, all the points you bring up are very valid ones, to where, you know, you're in this pristine environment where, you know, there's no sound, there's no chanting, there's no nothing. And you're just focused on what, you know, folks are saying. Description that, you know, Jake the Snake Roberts interviews were so good because he would talk at that slow monotone voice to where you had to get close to the TV to listen and pay attention to what he was saying. You know, now, you know, with, you know, when we had the pandemic and no crowds and stuff like that, you know, he had that luxury of being able to talk that low because nobody was going to out-talk him. Nobody was going to chant over him or react and stuff like that because there was no crowd.
Right.
But could that have happened in front of fans? I believe it could, just because Roman's that talented. Like again, you know, he just like Fatu, he comes from a great bloodline, and you know, he grew up in this business, you know, and stuff like that. So I mean, he's been, you know, he's doing phenomenal stuff with the bloodline and with Paul Heyman and the Usos and stuff like that. And he's the best in the business right now, as far as I'm, well, him, I love him. I love Randy Orton, you know, and,
yeah.
I love Orton just because he just takes his time, you know,
he's methodical. He's methodical. He's psychological. Yeah.
You know, we always tell the younger talent, you know, if you think you're going too slow, slow down even more. And,
yeah,
Randy he's perfect. Randy Orton's perfect. And,
yeah,
you know, and that just comes from me, you know, again, he grew up in the business. He came up in the business with, I mean, you know, you're surrounded by Ric Flair and Triple H, you know, you have no choice but to get better, you know, so. But Roman, you know, I know we're talking about Roman Reigns. I think he could have. It might have taken a different trajectory, if that, I could say that word with my fat tongue. I think Roman Reigns would have succeeded in either medium, whether, you know, it was, you know, no fans in the crowd because of the pandemic, or, you know, had the pandemic never happened. I think he would have succeeded, but it could have taken a little bit of a slight left or a slight right from what we're doing now.
Yeah.
Depending on the crowd.
I agree.
Yeah.
I agree. I think, and the other thing too, and this is, I'm sure this is going to light the group chat up. And again, if you disagree with my opinions, go ahead and hit me at This Is Goober on Twitter and Instagram. And also make sure you follow Blue Meanie at Blue Meanie BWO on Twitter. You'll know him because he has the blue check mark. So I like how they did that. I think they did that like especially for you, right? The blue. I feel like that was a nice little touch.
It was in the bargaining agreement between me and Twitter.
Negotiated it. Yeah. So I feel like, and I've always been one who has said this, and then we'll move on to other topics. I've always been one to say that I feel like the only person that could dethrone Roman Reigns in a meaningful way, it's not The Rock, it's not Brock Lesnar, it's not Big E, it's Drew McIntyre.
Oh, yeah.
Drew McIntyre is a very believable, very authentic character that succeeds in the most successful way. He's the most successful when he has a challenge in front of him, right?
Yeah.
Why did people get behind him so much in 2020? It's because he was up against Brock Lesnar. He had something to fight for. If they take this storyline and build it properly, I would absolutely love to see Drew McIntyre dethrone Roman Reigns. Dude, and I think he could do it.
Yeah, dude, the biggest, as far as wrestling goes, and the biggest crime in professional wrestling during the pandemic was the fact that, you know, Drew only got to be champion during the pandemic in front of no fans. Because, you know, right before the pandemic, you know, the shutdown happened, and you watched that crowd reaction to him win the Royal Rumble. My God.
Yeah.
My God, that's a baseball stadium. Well, baseball ballpark or whatever you want to call it. I know somebody else.
The entire crowd is just, I mean, you go back and watch it. I mean, the entire fucking place is on fire.
Yeah.
For Drew McIntyre when he kicked Brock Lesnar over the top rope, and then when he won, the place went fucking ballistic.
The build of that Royal Rumble might have been the perfect Royal Rumble. I mean, I'll spot you the Ric Flair win, because that was probably the best Royal Rumble ever.
That was 92, right?
Yeah, from talent.
Yeah.
From the talent. That roster. Oh my God.
Yeah, big time.
But, you know, the build of the Drew McIntyre Royal Rumble, where fans are like, oh, my God, they're really going to just have Brock eliminate everybody and, you know, blah, blah, blah. But then, like, the turning point where, you know, Brock becomes, you know, Keith Lee comes out, you know, and Brock's like, oh.
Who the fuck is this guy?
Yeah, this guy, you know, and they dropped the ball with that. They could have done so much more with Keith Lee, but they dropped the ball. Brock built that up, and Brock made people. And then just the fact that, you know, Drew comes out. Drew just looks like a fucking superhero. So put a fucking cape on the guy, man. Besides the fact that he's genuinely a good guy, man. You root for the good guys. Yeah. But he looks like he should be fighting Superman. You know,
he does. He's fucking jacked, dude. Yeah. He is the personification. Like, if there was one person, and I know, like, people there are, and even in the group chat here, Travis is saying, you know, they fucked up Drew too much for me as someone who still watches week to week. When they sat there and gave his sword a name, and my girlfriend started laughing, I was over Drew. I think, and I want to be careful how I sort of couch this. I think a lot of the things that they're doing now are a result of them not still trying to find their footing after coming back live.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, of course.
They were gone for 18 months in front of people. They didn't have anybody. So they're trying, like, it's the same thing with Lily, right? The Lily doll. They had to end that storyline because that kind of thing only worked inside of a pandemic Thunderdome era when you're doing, like, closed circuit TV, right?
That's a good way to put it.
It's not that I dislike the supernatural stuff. I enjoy the supernatural stuff, but I think with that character and that storyline, that only really works when you're behind a set, right?
Yeah.
So they had to get rid of it. It's the same thing with Drew. I mean, they're trying to find ways to continue his storyline, because at the end of the day, there are only so many people on the Raw roster that you can believably put against Drew. You have Bobby Lashley, you have Randy Orton, You know, unfortunately, I think they missed the ball with the Fiend aspect, but or even Bray Wyatt. I feel like they could have done something with the two of them together. I think that would have been a good program. But I don't know how many more opponents he could have had that were built up in a way that Drew was to be on that level. Right.
Right.
Now, and Travis, I don't disagree with you. I don't disagree that they didn't fuck up with Drew's run big time. I think there are a lot of mistakes that were made, but I do also think that a lot of this stuff that they're doing now was just sort of like a temporary time stop in order to get him to SmackDown in order to fight Roman, because I think that is what is, they've already set the groundwork for it. He's fighting Big E in Saudi Arabia and he's coming back, and he's already said on SmackDown he's coming after the Universal title. Now, there's the whole deal with The Rock not going to be able to be at WrestleMania this year. That was supposed to be a big payoff or something. It was supposed to be in Hollywood. Apparently, The Rock is not going to be there now. They need something. And in my mind, too, and Meanie, I'm sure you're in a lot of the same boat with this, things have a certain shelf life.
Yeah.
Do you think the Bloodline could effectively continue long term? Like, we're talking like 2 or 3 years, right? Hypothetically, let's say The Rock can't get to WWE for another 2 years. Do you think they could carry a storyline this long with Roman Reigns in an effective way to get to like 2 or 3 years later? Or do you think like this upcoming year would be the time for them to transition to like Drew as the Universal Champion?
I mean, it's hard to say, you know, old school days, you know, back when I grew up, when you can stretch a storyline out for 6 months, you can stretch one feud out for six months. You know, that would be ideal, but now It seems like WWE just, you know, they're very skittish. You know, they, something could be going good, and all of a sudden, we're going to make a hard left here. You know, it just takes a, you know, Vince, you know, ripping up a script last second. Oh, God damn it. This is bad shit, pal. You know, but, yeah, I mean, do I think they could? I think they could, because Roman right now is the face of WWE.
Yeah.
He's the voice of WWE. And, you know, the whole Bloodline thing, you know, yeah. Well, you brought up a couple of great points where you could just, you know, bring in new parts of the Bloodline, bringing in Naomi and stuff like that, and just have everybody... You know, it could be like an empire almost, you know, in different.
Right, right. That's what I mean. Keep talking. I'm sweating my balls off here. I'm taking a sweatshirt off. No, I agree. I think there's definitely parts of that. But I think my concern is, as far as Roman, not necessarily like an overexposure, but just the fact that people are like, ugh, okay, now he's beat Drew. Now he's beat Brock. You know, like, who's okay? Then he beats The Rock. And then what? You know, what's the payoff here?
Right, so. Right. And that's that's not an enviable task as far, you know, that's not an enviable task as far as being in the writer's room. But, you know, can they do it? I think they could. But, you know, it just takes, who becomes available at that point too? Because there, you know, you could, there could be a talent out there that, you know, could come in and, you know, become a fresh new spark as far as a matchup goes, you know, like,
right,
you know, hey, somebody could say, or you know fuck, you know what if they say, man, we're just wasting Bron Breakker down here on NXT, let's bring him up, you know, and change his name, please.
First, if they pull him up and they don't immediately change his name to Rex Steiner,
yeah,
and don't give him the mesh, I'm gonna lose my shit. That dude sounds just like Scott Steiner,
and the crazy,
just like Scott Steiner.
Yeah, the crazy,
and wrestles like his dad. Like, I've never, like, and he didn't even start wrestling until like 6 months ago, right?
I don't know his backstory, but
I think he started in like February. Yeah, and the dude is fucking insane,
dude. I won't lie. I'm new to the Bron Breakker character, you know, but
right.
Good lord, if there's a guy who's
dude,
if there's a guy who's believable. And a guy him. You can pull up to, you know, you don't want to do things too fast too soon, but.
Right, but
on the believability factor?
Yeah, man.
Bron Breakker looks like he fucks some shit up, you know?
Dude, strike while the iron's hot with that one, too. Yeah. He's young, he's fresh, he's over.
Yeah.
The guy can fucking go. Like, just pull him up as quickly. Give him a year, tops. Pull him up. Pull him up by the end of the year.
Yeah.
He's ready. He's ready.
What?
He's clearly ready because he gave the Scott Steiner promo. Like, what did he say? If you're if you want a friend, go get a dog. Like, I mean, like, who says that shit?
Yeah.
I'll tell you who. Rex Steiner. That's who says it.
You want to talk about bloodline?
Yeah. Yeah, dude. Oh, my God. Yes. Yes. Then they bring the Steiner, bro. Bring the Steiners back. That's what they should do.
They're available.
That's a great idea.
Yeah.
I know there's some legality, apparently, according to the rumor and innuendo.
Yeah.
There is some legality with the Steiner name.
Yeah.
But I think there's a way around that. I think there's a way to fix that. And I think they could absolutely make a fucking killing doing that with the new Steiner bloodline. But Meanie.
Yes.
What else is going on, man? What else is happening?
Oh, dude, I had a fantastic weekend last weekend with, Retromania Wrestling, the video game.
Yeah, I saw the pictures. It looks like you guys had a good, the entire BWO was there, right?
Yeah, one of the rare times they can get Stevie, me, and Nova in the same room at the same time. And it was awesome. Shout out to Mike Herman, owner and creator of RetroSoft Studios, Retromania Wrestling. We were at the Too Many Games video game convention for Friday, Saturday. And then, from the convention, we drove over to Tom's River for Donnie B's standalone wrestling show, The Big Bang. And that was great as well. But, I am so proud of the work we've done with Retromania Wrestling as far as, the concept of being contacted, to do the game. I was contacted initially by a gentleman named Mike Archer, who did video games for WWE and a bunch of different companies. And, Mike Herman, I reached, Mike Archer, had Mike Archer come on board. And once I heard Mike Archer was on board for the game, I was totally down to do it. I want to be in a video game anyway, but anything that's like the, WrestleFest, the old school arcade game. And then, they got the blessing from the original company to be the official sequel to WrestleFest.
Whoa.
Definitely a no-brainer. But, it was a great day. Mike Herman's very smart. He did a limited run of, I'm grateful that he decided to do a BWO arena for the game.
Yeah.
That's going to be, you could download that soon on all the platforms. But he got cases for each platform, PS4, Xbox, Switch. And I'm sure I'm leaving something out. But like each cover was a custom BWO Retromania cover. And on the back, he had us sign all, every different version. We signed all the posters and
that's awesome,
and
man.
And stuff like that. And I snagged one for myself. I should have brought it up to the Trey Meanie Studios here. But, dude, it was such a great weekend. We did a panel, which was fun. It was cool. I think we got, our panel got a decent reaction. Because, you never know. You're at a video. Right. You're not at a wrestling convention. You're at a video game convention. And you're like, man, I hope people come over. And we had a pretty good... We had a pretty good turnout. You don't want to be like Spinal Tap, just sitting there in front of an empty room, But it was really cool. The game's awesome. They had the cabinet there. They had a version you could play with on the Xbox there, and it was cool just to be around Stevie and Nova for a couple of days. We are rarely in the same room at the same time, and it was an amazing weekend.
That's awesome, man. It looked like you guys had a great time. It looked like everything was a lot of fun, and it was cool to see the BWO back together. I really enjoyed that. Where can everybody find the game? Is it out yet? Is it still coming? Like, it's already out?
Well, here's the cool thing about the game is it's been out since February, but
oh no shit. Okay, then fuck me, I'm an idiot.
No. But that goes to my point of it was so cool to watch people come up to our table and go, oh, when's the game coming out? And you go, hey, it's out. You can buy it right now. And people just, without even thinking, oh, absolutely. And people would, you know, buy their, you know, the game for the platform that they like. You would buy it, you would get the case, you would get the download code. You throw in a bunch of really cool things into the case, like stickers, all that good stuff. And then we would sign the case. Just that process of watching people realize, oh, here's a cool wrestling game. Oh, the game's out now. Oh, I can buy it here. And the guys who are actually in the game will sign the poster and the video game case. Nah, it was awesome. And Mike Herman, genius move. And he's got a lot of cool things coming up for the game as far as, you know, downloadable content and more arenas. Yeah. You know, it was very special that, you know, he has a BWO arena, but then he did an arena for, because we did the show for Donnie B, and we were having an angle where the BWO was going up against the Corluzzo Collection Agency, which was, there was a legendary promoter in the Jersey Philly area named Dennis Corluzzo, and they brought in his son Mark. And Mark is basically a spinning image of his dad. And we're doing a feud between the BWO and the CCA. So in the game, they have a special Corluzzo Collection Agency arena, which Dennis Corluzzo, legendary promoter, he helped me, he helped Nova, he helped guys like Chris Candido, try to say that again.
say it five times fast, yeah.
Yeah, he helped Crowbar. You know, he helped so many guys, and just to have his name involved in the video game is pretty cool.
That is pretty cool, man.
Yeah.
Now, for some reason, for a second, I thought did you say Corluzzo Collection Agency?
Yeah.
For some reason, I thought about the FBI, the Full Blooded Italians, and and Vito Lagrasso, and what was Little Guido? Right? Is that the
yeah?
The guy that took that gigantic power bomb from the Undertaker that time? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah,
but yeah, it was along those lines. Like, you know, Dennis, you know, he ran shows in Jersey, but he also did a stint down in Memphis and Smoky Mountain, you know, with the Corluzzo Collection Agency, where he would feud with Lawler and stuff like that. But so it was cool to have a little nod to him in the game, because he did a lot for so many of the wrestlers.
Yeah, that's really, I love when that's one of the coolest things about, you know, the retro mania and the retro stuff that's been going on. It's really quite amazing to see all of the throwbacks and all the time. I know Cella Toys has been doing a bunch of stuff as well. As far as like pulling from the old school, man. And I love it. Hashtag Sorensen Level has joined us.
Yeah.
Welcome, sir.
What's up, buddy?
Welcome to Mind of the Meanie. Excuse me. I am choking here a little bit, but while I'm choking, let's get ready to do Ask Meanie.
I would love to.
It's time to ask me anything.
Ask me something.
All right. Here we go. I'm pulling up. Don't forget, guys, you follow us on at Mind of the Meanie on Twitter and use hashtag Ask Meanie. So you can ask us your questions each week. Either myself or Josh, whoever is steering the ship that day with the Blue Meanie, will ask. Ringside Rant, friend of both Mind of the Meanie and Foundation Radio.
Nice.
What would the BWO look like today in regards to the members with current workers?
I think we did that question on the last episode.
Did you guys do that last time? All right, let me see. I apologize. Here we go. Let's find
you
the next
should.
One.
Should. No, I'm scared.
Let's go. Here we go. 15 hours. And the wrong one. Here we go. Let's loop it back. Pull it back. Here we go. Here, friend of the show for both Foundation Radio and Mind of the Meanie, Ringside Rant. Thank you for the rewind, sir. If you were the Eagles GM, what would you do to get the team back to the promised land?
Run the fucking ball, man. Run the fucking ball. Dude, I love this team. I don't want to think they're tanking this season just to, get the... Because the Philadelphia Eagles potentially have three picks in the first... have three picks in the first eight picks next year in the first round.
Wow.
They have their pick. They have a pick for Miami. And if Carson Wentz plays 75% of his snaps... the Eagles get another first-round pick. And the Colts' record's not that good right now. So, potentially, if the season were to end today, the Eagles would have three picks within the first eight picks of next year's draft in the first round. So, who knows if, you know, they're saying, hey, hey, you know, pump the brakes here. Let's get these picks. Let's get a fucking middle linebacker in here. This the Philadelphia Eagles have not done anything to address the middle linebacker situation. Their defense is playing softer to baby shit. You know, just it's just like holy
that's
shit.
That's soft, folks.
Yeah,
that's soft.
Yeah, they've never done anything to address that situation. I would run the ball, but again, you know, you get into the thing of first year coach. Jalen Hurts played three games last year, but they're glorified preseason games because there was no preseason. So, to me, this is his real first year, even though he's technically not a rookie. And then you go back and look at other coaches who've had first years. You know, Andy Reid, I think went 1-15 his first year as a coach and stuff like that. But these are growing pains. You know, always
yeah.
You know, you get a new coach in there, you usually try to give him like 3 years to, find his voice, so to speak, and call a game. But definitely, I would address the middle linebacker through the draft. Try to get a veteran coach on this coaching staff because this coaching staff is young. You know, when Andy Reid first, became coach at Philadelphia Eagles, he got Jim Johnson, who –
Right.
Veteran coach, had experience. Somebody he could go to, hey, man, what would you do in this situation? Nick Sirianni, the coach of the Eagles, everybody is basically his peer. You know, they're on the same level. Get somebody in there with a little bit more coach experience that, you go, like a Yoda type that you could go to and go, what would you do in this situation? So there's so many things they could do. Again, I hate to say they're tanking, but they just traded away Zach Ertz too. That kind of was a gut punch, A little inside baseball. We're doing this on a Saturday. They traded Zach on a Friday after the Thursday night game. And
unbelievable.
Yeah. Well, to be honest, I thought he was going to be traded in the offseason because he wanted an extension. Mm. And they were being thrifty because, basically their hands are tied because, the Carson Wentz trade and the cap hit with that.
Right.
So, you trade away Zach Ertz. You get a cornerback back. You free up some cap space. I would extend Dallas Goedert, who is probably one of the best tight ends in football, underutilized by the Eagles. I would extend, if I'm the GM, address middle linebacker in the draft, extend Dallas Goedert, and get another coach in here who has slightly more coaching experience than Nick Sirianni.
It's funny that that somebody mentioned the Eagles today. I was talking to somebody at work yesterday at my shoot job. We were talking about Carson Wentz and Nick Foles and the Tom Brady Super Bowl win. I sat there and talked and I was just frustrated. I feel frustrated a lot of times when I think about the Eagles, right? Because I think about something like Nick Foles and that Super Bowl win and how he was the backup quarterback. And we invested all of this time, effort and energy into Carson Wentz to really not get a ton out of him.
Right.
You know, I mean, it really, really wasn't. He was like the modern day Donovan McNabb. And I know that this, again, I guess me, I'm just full of controversial opinions today, Meanie, but looking back on it, man, Terrell Owens, I got to tell you, man, he wasn't wrong with what he said about Donovan McNabb. He wasn't wrong. He choked at the Super Bowl. I don't think it was a professional thing to say, but I don't necessarily think he was wrong.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, I think there may have been a better, more professional way to go about that, but I don't necessarily think it was wrong because... And I think in some aspects, looking back on that entire thing, if you don't know what I'm talking about, go back and look up the stuff during Terrell Owens' time in the Philadelphia Eagles organization. It was controversial at best. But I think at a certain point, he's probably feeling like everybody's attacking me. Everybody's talking shit about me, saying that I'm the bad guy here. I'm the one that's not, boosting morale on the team, and I'm not doing this and I'm not doing that. But what about Donovan McNabb, who can barely throw the fucking football? And I never could understand why McNabb stayed on the team for as long as he did. You know, you had somebody like AJ Feely come in and crush it in the same aspect as Nick Foles. You have a great backup quarterback. You have a great second backup quarterback. You know, you have other people who can fucking handle this and play the game 100 times better than these guys. So why do we continue to keep dumping money into like Carson Wentz and guys like Donovan McNabb, who are clearly not what we signed up for? And I don't know how that works. You know, what do you think?
I think Donovan McNabb was, you know, a great quarterback, but like he would just get set in his ways. I listen to sports talk radio here in Philly. My boy, Johnny Marks, he's got a great radio show with Ike Reese. I love Ike Reese.
Oh, yeah. Ike Reese is great. Yeah.
I just ordered a Ike Reese jersey.
Nice. Nice.
I've always wanted an Ike Reese jersey, so that's coming in the mail soon. And
nice.
He tells a story. Like, he'll throw in some nuggets. Like behind inside baseball stories with the Eagles, and he said there was a certain play, the Eagles were playing the Giants, and T.O. was in the huddle with Donovan McNabb. He's like, "Man, I was open on that play. I'm getting open." And Donovan turns to T.O. and says, "Man, shut the fuck up." And from that point on, Terrell Owens just turned on Donovan. Like right in the huddle, in the heat of the moment, I went, "Man, just shut the fuck up." And from that point, T.O. was like, "Shit's on." You know, T.O. was a very prideful guy. if you watch his introductory press conference, you know, his name's Terrell Owens, and Andy Reid says, Terrell Owens, and he corrects Andy Reid right away. No, it's Terrell. You know, he's like one of those prideful guys. Like, he won't be disrespectful. Yeah. And then Donovan, in the huddle in front of all the teammates, is told to shut the fuck up. That's when things went south.
I don't know if I would not have reacted the same way as Terrell Owens, though. I mean, that's, you know. I get in a certain aspect, right? And again, I've never played professional sports. I've never wrestled. I've never done anything like that. I'm just a guy who watches, right? But I think for me personally, if I'm in a situation and I know I'm not being utilized, or I know something's coming up and the person's first response is to tell me to shut the fuck up, I'm going to be like, "Yo, fuck you and your mother." You know, like, I'm not going to take that kind of shit from anybody.
Yeah.
Especially if I know that I'm like trying to help, you know, I'm trying to do the right thing here. But again, I don't know. I mean, that's probably why I never did anything like this. Cause I got a fucking attitude problem when it comes to that. But I don't know, man. I think Wentz is a worse quarterback than McNabb. Let me just make sure I'm clear on that.
Wentz had potential.
He had potential,
right. But he kept getting sidelined. Kept
shitting the bed.
Yeah.
Yeah, he kept shitting the bed.
Well, he kept getting injured.
Yeah.
I mean, that 2017 season, he was playing lights out, and then, you know, against the Rams, he gets both, you know, ligaments in his knee blown out.
Oh, that's right.
I was at that game, which is weird. But you couldn't tell. You didn't know at the time because he's walking back to the locker room, and he walked by my section. I was like 10 rows from the field, and he's walking, and you hear the crowd coming up. Like, you hear like a ooh, ooh, you know, come around and say, and then, oh, my God, there's one's walking by. You know, you think maybe it's a concussion because he's walking back to the locker room. And then, oh, no, he blew out his knee. Shit. And, you know, he blew out his knee and still played two more plays. And threw he was a quarterback without a knee throwing a touchdown pass to a guy who had a torn rotator cuff, you know.
Jesus.
And Alshon Jeffrey, which is bizarre. But, you know, he kept getting injured. And then they really didn't do anything to, you know, to help him.
Yeah, I guess you're right. Yeah, maybe I'm being a little too hard on Mr. Wentz here.
Well, Nick Foles was the mistress, you know. Not the mistress. There was the ex, you know, because
he is the stepdad of the Philadelphia Eagles.
Well, no, Nick Foles was originally the Philadelphia Eagles quarterback, and then that idiot Chip Kelly traded him away. God. And then they bring him back. So it's like, you know, ex-sex. You know, just, you know, they kept going back to the ex. You know, while your new bride's right here, the new bride's like, hey. You know. So he's playing in the shadow of, you know, the guy who replaced him and won the Super Bowl.
Oh, that's got to be a dick. That's got to be a huge, like, dick pie. That, you know, like, fuck, man, this is brutal.
That same ex almost took him back to the playoffs. And one Alshon Jeffrey catch away from maybe going back to the NFC Championship game, hopefully playing in another Super Bowl. You know, Nick Foles goes away. I think he went to Jacksonville.
Yep. Jacksonville, yeah.
And then, you know, you're Carson Wentz, you're like, phew, it's just me. I'm the main quarterback. Next year, second round in the draft, Jalen Hurts. What?
Yep.
What the fuck? You know, he's always had to play in the shadow of his backup, you know?
Yeah.
But
no, I can see how that could be, that could be extremely frustrating.
There's so much
to it. I can see how that would be. Yeah.
But he had potential, but like he was you know where I think things really went bad was, and this just dawned on me, and you know, he gets to his first playoff game, you know, Nick Foles is gone. He carries the Philadelphia Eagles, you know, who started off shaky, to the playoffs. They win their division, and then they're playing Seattle, and he gets concussed within the first, like, 10 minutes of that game. I think that concussion really did a number on Carson.
I think so.
I think, you know, everything he went through with the Nick Foles saga, and then he gets a concussion, and then while he's, I think he... That's the scary thing about concussions. You don't know how long the side effects last. And then you know, most people who've had severe concussions like that say you're ultra emotional. And then when they go in the second round and pick a backup quarterback who eventually is going, you know the fans are going to be calling for if you start to stink. So the Eagles really did nothing to help them. Like just right now, they're doing nothing to help Jalen Hurts. I mean, Jalen needs to step up his game too a little bit, but you know they're really not. You're a rookie quarterback in your first year, and you're throwing over 50 times a game when you should be running and getting used to the rhythm of the speed of the NFL. You know, the Eagles really have done no favors to their quarterbacks.
I got to say, watching the group chat here, the pod squad light up as you talk about the Eagles. I want to make sure I point this out, this comment by Travis. Travis says, as much as I'm not a sports guy, I love listening to the Blue Meanie talk about the Eagles. Meanie talks about the Eagles with the same passion he talks about Van Halen. And bro, I got to tell you, I absolutely agree. I could listen to Blue Meanie talk about the Eagles and Van Halen all day long. So Travis had one more question since we have time for one more question
sure,
here.
Sure.
Travis wants to know the Eagles' dream draft. What year are you joining the Eagles, and what position are you playing?
Well, anytime I make myself in Madden, I play middle linebacker. I either play middle linebacker or I'm a big fan of defense. I love watching. I love watching a defender break through the line and just sack the shit out of the quarterback, like Javon Hargrave did. 2 weeks ago in Carolina, he just here's a fucking play. Javon Hargrave broke through the fucking offensive line. It's like the guy went ole and let him through, and he Jesus. Just fucking sacks that guy. It's like something out of a movie. So I would always pick like a defensive. I always wanted to be a defender, either on the line, because I was a big fucking Reggie White fan too. Reggie and Jerome. That's my tag.
Yeah.
That's my tag team right there. Fucking or middle line, anywhere where you could just break through the line and fucking tackle the quarterback. Jersey number probably would have been either 73 or 93. So 73 years I was born, and for some reason I love the number 93 too. 93 as well, I should say. But yeah,
my number would be 69. No, I'm just kidding. Actually, here's one more question for you.
Sure.
Because I find this interesting, and then we'll wrap up for today. Liam Savage wants to know, do you get insulted if a fan uses wrestling lingo like shoot or heat and think that's just for people on the inside, or do you accept that it's part of the fan culture now?
If it's done the right way. To me... When you talk to me and ask me a question or have a conversation with me, it's all in the approach. Are you saying it to ask, you know, be inquisitive, you know, like genuinely want to know something? Or are you approaching me that you want to just show off that, you know, insider lingo? Like, You know, like, yeah. Like, I'm the guy who's reading WebMD, and I go to the doctor's office, and I go, I have this thing in my shoulder, and I start reading off the things I read on WebMD that if you do this, I think you should give me this pill, you know, to treat my shoulder. Well, sorry, I'm the one with the fucking medical degree here. I'll tell you what's wrong with you, and I'll treat you and tell you what. It's all in the approach, you know? If people are having, like, a genuine conversation, and they use it and say, I'm cool with it. You know, I was that guy. I did a couple of dickhead things, you know, when I was a smart mark, you know. Big Josh, you know, Matt Bourne's walking to the fucking ring, and I go, oh, Big Josh, you're Matt Bourne. And what's you supposed to do? Turn around and go, you got me, you know.
Right.
I was that asshole, you know, so... You know, and I want to punch myself in the face for it. But, you know, using insider lingo, I don't mind. It, like I said, it's all in the approach. If you're genuine, being genuine, if it's just casual and you're not going, hey, look, I know a smart word. I always use this analogy. Nirvana has a song, I'll say in Bloom. I think it's in Bloom. And the lyric is, he's the one who likes all our pretty songs, and he likes to sing along, and he likes to shoot his gun, but he don't know what it means. A lot of times wrestling fans, you know, they know the wrestling, they know the lingo, they want to sing along and use the lingo, but sometimes they don't really know what the lingo means. You know, people are like, for the longest time, people are like, oh, this office, they're burying Daniel Bryan, he's so over. If they were burying Daniel Bryan, he wouldn't be on TV. If being in a major storyline against Triple H and Stephanie is being buried, let me hand you my fucking shovel and bury me that way, because you're on national TV with the fucking bosses, and the fans bought into it. They thought he was legit being buried. It was great to watch the fans fucking freak out thinking that he was genuinely being buried, but he's on TV every week. If WWE wants to bury somebody, you're off TV, and they'll send you back down to back in the day that, they let me go, and then the fans had that Save the Meanie campaign. And then they're like, hey, maybe we give him another chance. So the next time comes around, we'll send him down to Memphis. Keep him out of sight, out of mind. So when we slowly, release him, on the down low, there won't be as much of a outrage.
A pushback.
Yeah.
Yeah. I got to tell you, man. And again, I don't use words like bury or mark or shoot or work. Like, I'm not in the industry, right? I'm not a wrestler. I don't use words like that because it's for me, it would be disrespectful, right?
Yeah.
But I fucking love these guys, the wrestling cosplay journalists, as friend of the show, Eric Bischoff calls them, who are like, they're burying Bray Wyatt, and they're just totally burying him and doing this and doing that. And it's like, guys, Bray Wyatt is fucking over.
Yeah.
If there's something that's not working, they're going to retool it. Right. Like, this is all shut up and enjoy the show. Like, it's just, and it's like on, like, I'm, it's the same thing on Twitter. All these people screaming at each other about AEW and WWE. And, you know, like, I like to have a good time. I like to mess around. Like, I put a tweet up yesterday about something Tony Khan said, and I likened it to a Donald Trump tweet where he was talking about Ted Turner. I've never met Ted Turner, but I think he's terrible. Like, it was the first thing I thought about. And I have no beef with Tony Khan. It was just, it was the first thing that popped into my head. Yeah. Like, I have no beef. Like, I want to be clear, no beef with Tony Khan. It was just the way it read. I was like, this reads like a Donald Trump tweet, you know? And I was like laughing to myself as I wrote it, right? But I try not to get involved in like all that back and forth bullshit, because it's just like, just enjoy the show. You know, I'm going to call out things that I think that I would like to see be better. And I think things that should be changed. But I just hate when people use the words improperly and they use it incorrectly. It drives me insane. So please make sure.
I could see somebody going, I would love seeing so-and-so be used more.
Right. Something like that is different. That's a different thing.
But to say so-and-so needs to be pushed. What's a push? How do you know? How do you know that guy can handle the push? Because once you
right.
you know, I learned this from, you know, people who fight in MMA. They're like, yeah, you're big and tough in the press conferences, but once, you know, you get in that octagon and the lights are on you, some people shrink. You're going to attach a rocket to somebody. You're going to push them. How do you know they can handle the push? You know, so.
And also, who decides who needs to be pushed? Vince McMahon decides. And it just, I'm sure we could go on about this forever. But like, it's you know, just be respectful to Meanie and the other guys who have busted their asses for so many years in this industry. And just make sure that you are doing the right thing and you're not, blowing hot air.
It's all in the approach, you know.
And yeah, I mean, it really is. And just be, you know, like I said, don't blow hot air. And Meanie, speaking of air, autumn is in the air. The pumpkins are in patch and our friends at Manscaped are here to make sure you don't carve your pants pumpkins when you're grooming, if you know what I'm saying. Make sure you're keeping things fresh this fall with the leaders in male grooming and their brand new fourth generation performance package. Boys, get ready for cuffing season like no other. Ready to take the leap into fall with Manscaped? Join the 2 million men worldwide using Manscaped by going to manscaped.com for 20% off plus free shipping with the promo code Meanie20. And Meanie, I got to tell you, the other day, little John and the East Side Boys were looking a bit bushy, and I wasn't sure what to do. I grabbed the beard trimmer that I use, which is fucking disgusting, but I didn't have anything else to use. And I started to do it, and I nicked myself, man. I nicked myself right on the side of the goodies, the groceries. And it was terrible. And I thought, wait a minute, what am I doing? I have the Manscaped Performance Package here, the Performance Package 4.0, and I trimmed it up, and now it's as sleek and as smooth as my beard line. I know, Meanie, you have the same issues sometimes. Tell me more about your experiences with Manscaped.
Oh, dude, you know, there's nothing worse than the nicks and cuts that come along with using the age old beard trimmer, the thing they use in the military to buzz your head with. You know, you shouldn't be buzzing your boys. But you know, I'm a big fan of everything Manscaped does, from below the belt to above the neck with the ears and ear and nose trimmer. You know, like I keep saying, I'm getting to that Ernest Borgnine stage in life where, you know, where my ear and nose needs to be trimmed up a little bit. So, you know, Manscaped provides everything to keep you looking sharp and keep things, and Manscaped keeps everything, you know, looking presentable, you know, from below the belt to above the neck.
Yes. And I know Mrs. Meanie appreciates it. I know my wife, Courtney, appreciates it. And remember, guys, it's time to bundle up with the Manscaped Performance Package 4.0. Inside the package, you'll find their Lawnmower 4.0 trimmer, Weed Whacker ear and nose hair trimmer, the Crop Preserver ball deodorant, Crop Reviver toner, Performance Boxer Briefs, and a travel bag to hold your goodies. And we're not just talking about your balls, guys. We're talking about the goodies from Manscaped, right? The new Performance Package 4.0 includes the new Lawnmower 4.0. If you're looking to cozy up this fall, this trimmer is essential. Their fourth generation trimmer features a cutting-edge ceramic blade to reduce grooming accidents thanks to their advanced skin-safe technology. It also gives you the ability to turn on the 4000K LED spotlight on and off when needed for a more precise shave, plus it's waterproof. So if you're like me and you like to shower in the dark, you can make sure your balls look great too. Seal the deal with Manscaped's liquid formulation, their Crop Preserver ball deodorant. Everybody knows pumpkin spice lattes and ball deodorant go hand in hand. And who doesn't like a set of pumpkin spice smelling balls? The Performance Package 4.0 also includes the Weed Whacker to chop up the worst weeds up top in your nose and your ear. The nose and ear hair trimmer uses a 9,000 RPM motor-powered 360-degree rotary dual-blade system to provide proprietary skin-safe technology, which helps prevent nicks, snags, and tugs in those delicate holes. Then after trimming the pumpkin patch and whacking the leaves, give your balls a boost and use the Crop Reviver. Manscaped even threw in two free gifts to their Performance Package 4.0, the Manscaped Boxers and the Shed Travel Bag. Get comfy on home and are at home and on the go this season. So remember, get 20% off and free shipping by using the promo code Meanie20 at manscaped.com. That's 20% off free shipping with the code Meanie20 at manscaped.com. Make your balls a priority this fall. Choose Manscaped. Your balls will thank you. And Meanie, I have to also say again, thank you so much for letting me tag in.
Oh,
Josh,
my pleasure.
Should be back next. Son of a bitch. God damn it. We forgot again, Meanie.
Oh, man.
Shit. I do this every single week. Every week I'm on the show, man. Al Snow, I'm so goddamn sorry, dude. Every time.
At this point, I'm surprised he hasn't just like barged in. And just like
he just hasn't done a run in yet. Yeah. I'm waiting for it. And then I have to like explain myself and like I'm concerned.
Al's a shooter. He trained Dan Severn for the UFC. He is more than capable than taking my large head and shoving it up my own ass. So we can't next week. I mean, he has to come on this show.
We really have to do this because the last thing I want is my head planted firmly in my rectum. So Al Snow, please just accept my sincerest and genuine apologies, and please send any hate mail to Josh Chernoff. Meanie, thank you so much for allowing me to stop by and co-host and co-pilot Mind of the Meanie. Where can everybody find you on social media?
If you would like to follow the Blue Meanie, go to Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, Blue Meanie BWO. If you would like a cameo video, go to cameo.com/BlueMeanieBWO. If you would like to support the Blue Meanie, go to ProWrestlingTees.com/BlueMeanie. Or if you want to support Mind of the Meanie, go to ProWrestlingTees.com/MindOfTheMeanie. You can also follow Mind of the Meanie on all social media platforms, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at Mind of the Meanie. And you can support Josh Chernoff. Go to all social media platforms at So Says Chernoff. Go to ProWrestlingTees.com/So Says Chernoff. Get my favorite shirt. Sarcasm is my superpower. And where can we find you?
Thank you, Mr. Meanie. I appreciate you, sir. Thank you. You can find me on socials, on Twitter and Instagram, at This Is Goober. You can also follow my show, Foundation Radio, every Tuesdays, wherever you get your favorite podcasts. And you can find it at foundationradio.net. Got a lot of great content in the archive. You can also go and support me and tell everyone you're an Adam Bernard guy by going to ProWrestlingTees.com/MindOfTheMeanie and picking yourself up one of my favorite shirts, as well as our official CM Punk Eat the Shoe t-shirt, which, CM Punk, we're ready for you, bro. Let's do it. Don't forget to pick up your action figures as well. Your Josh Chernoff and Blue Meanie action figures. There's very limited quantities left. My sincerest hope is that this year, before the end of the year, there will be the Not Josh Chase variant. So, Chella Toys, if you're listening, I'm ready for my close-up. So, Meanie, Blue Meanie, thank you again so much for having me. It's always a pleasure. The Pod Squad, I love seeing everybody on the show here and getting a chance to talk to everybody. For the Blue Meanie, my name is Adam Barnard, and we will see you again next week on Mind of the Meanie.
Blue World Order. The world of MLW Radio never stops.